Right. So nutrition is unicellular animals. Okay. Unicellular animal means the animal which is having only one cell as its complete body. When only one cell is its complete body, automatically the entire surface is in direct contact with the environment. So most of the life process are carried out by means of simple diffusion alone. Whereas in the case of multicellular animals, it is not possible, because in multicellular animals there are lot many cells in the body, and most of the cells are not in direct contact with the environment. So special tissues or organs or organ systems are used to carry out the life process. Coming to the unicellular animals and nutrition. Example for one such unicellular animal is amoeba, and we are going to discuss about even paramecium also. Amoeba captures its food by forming pseudopodia or false feet. Pseudopodia or false feet. Whenever it is coming across a food particle, the protoplasm pushes the plasma membrane at two points, so that from those two points pseudopodia are formed, and they enclose the food particle, and wherever they are enclosing the pseudopodia, they just fuse together and a food vacuole is going to be formed. So food vacuole is formed by the fusion of pseudopodia enclosing the food particle, and digestion will be carried out inside the food vacuole, right? Okay, coming to paramecium. Yes, some digestive juices will be released into that food vacuole from the cytoplasm, so that the food will be digested inside the food vacuole. Okay. Amoeba is not having any fixed shape, so it can form pseudopodia at any area of its surface. Whereas paramecium, it is called slipper animalcule, because the shape of the paramecium is like a slipper. A fixed shape is present. Right? And surrounding this surface, it has got many small hair-like structures, which are called cilia. So, in amoeba, the food is taken into the cell at any place on the surface. Whereas in paramecium, it is not like that. Food will be taken into the cell only at a specific spot. Okay? Right? A specific spot is present through which only the food will be taken in. Then, how the food is going to move to that place? Is paramecium going to form any pseudopodia? No, it cannot form any pseudopodia. As it is not able to form the pseudopodia and it is having a fixed shape, it cannot capture the food at any place from the surface. And food will be just taken into the cell only at a specific spot. So food will be directed to this spot by the movement of cilia. So, movement of cilia directs the food to the spot through which the food is taken into the cell. So, this is how the food enters into paramecium body, and inside, once the food moves inside, same food vacuole is formed, then the digestive juices are released inside that food vacuole, the food will be digested and absorbed. Right. Next, human nutrition. Human is a complex multicellular animal and the level of body organization is organ system level of organization. Among multicellular animals, there are different levels of body organization. Tissue level, organ level and organ system level. We are belonging to the organ system level of body organization. So human nutrition, it is carried out by our digestive system. Digestive system is a specific organ system by which human nutrition is completed. Human nutrition has got total 5 stages. They are ingestion, digestion, absorption, assimilation, and excretion, not excretion. Some are using the word excretion. Excretion is completely different from excretion in the case of human beings like animals. Okay? In the case of birds like animals, both excretion and excretion are carried out together. In the case of humans, excretion is different, excretion is different. Excretion is the discarding of undigested food through anus. Excretion is the removal and discarding of metabolic wastes through urethra. Okay, so excretion is carried out through urethra in the case of humans. Excretion is carried out through anus. Okay, and all these 5 stages of human nutrition are carried out at different parts of elementary canal or gut. What is elementary canal? It is also called gut. Don't get confused. Gut or elementary canal, both are same. Elementary canal is a long extended tube starting from mouth ending with anus. Mouth, oral cavity, esophagus, stomach, small intestine, large intestine, I am directly writing anus, I am not writing the other 2 parts here. Okay? Right. As I said, this is one tube only, but at different places, different activities are carried out among these 5. Are you getting it? Except this assimilation, remaining 4 steps are going to be carried out at different places. Let us see which phase is carried out at which particular part. Ingestion. The intake of food into our body is called ingestion. Mouth is the part through which ingestion is taking place. What is mouth? The opening of elementary canal, that's it. The opening of the entry point of elementary canal is mouth. Don't get confused. It is a very simple thing. This, only this much is mouth. Then what is inside? When you say, I am keeping in the mouth. Through the mouth, you are keeping in oral cavity. This is inside, this is oral cavity. Right? Next, excretion is carried out through anus. Excretion is carried out through anus. Okay. So, what is the definition of mouth? The entry point of elementary canal. Then, what will be anus? The exit of elementary canal. Right?
right? Like how a cinema theater will be having entry and exit. For the same door, okay, in the front side it is written entry. At the other side, when you are coming from inside to outside, they will write exit. But here it is not like that. Two different things are there. There are some animals where cinema theater like doors are there. Entry and exit. Hydra. Okay? Hydra is the animal. Mouth and anus both are same. It is having only one pore. Through the same mouth, it will go. I mean, first food enters and undigested food will come out from the same point. Right? So it is only a what's that? Digestive pore like that, you have to use the word. Right. Okay. Let us not go with the Hydra here. Coming to. So ingestion, digestion over. What are the remaining steps? Digestion, absorption. Where digestion takes place? Digestion takes place at three different areas. Digestion takes place at three different parts of the alimentary canal. First one is oral cavity, which is also called buccal cavity. Okay, which is also called buccal cavity. Next, esophagus, in this one, no digestion takes place. No digestion, no absorption, nothing takes place. And what is its role? It is only a connecting pipe between oral cavity and the stomach. So, digestion takes place first at oral cavity, next at stomach, next in the small intestine. Next in the small intestine. So, oral cavity, stomach, and small intestine. These are the three areas where digestion takes place. Absorption. Absorption of the final digested end products, it occurs in small intestine, and absorption of the large volumes of water, it occurs in large intestine. Final digested end products, excluding water. Final digested end products means water is not absorbed here. But glucose, amino acids, fatty acids, nucleotides like final digested end products of carbohydrates, lipids, nucleic acids and proteins, they are absorbed at a small intestine. Okay, small intestine. And large volumes of water from the undigested food will be absorbed in the large intestine. But which substances are getting absorbed in which intestine, that you need to remember. Okay. Don't write water will be absorbed by small intestine and final digestion products will be absorbed by large intestine like that. That is wrong. Next, assimilation. After absorption, the blood will be carrying the final digested end products to different cells of our body. And inside each and every cell, these final digested end products are utilized for various metabolic activities, for the construction of proteins, for the construction of lipids, for the construction of nucleic acid, for the generation of energy, like catabolic and anabolic activities. Totally, we can say both together, metabolic activities. So, final digested end products are utilized in individual cells for various metabolic activities. This process is called assimilation. Means assimilation is getting utilized. Okay. Formation of final digested end product is what? That is digestion. And taking them into blood, that is absorption. Getting utilization of those end products is assimilation. Don't get confused. What is digestion? Formation of final digested end products, that is digestion. Okay. Taking them into blood and bringing them to individual cells, that is absorption, right? And then utilizing them for various metabolic activities, that is assimilation. Okay, but here we are going to discuss more about digestion and just a little definition of absorption. Assimilation, as a definition, will be whatever just now I have discussed, that much only. We are not going to discuss much about it. Okay, right. And how digestion takes place, that let us start now. Okay. What is digestion? Breakdown of the complex foods into simpler units of various biomolecules. What is digestion? Breakdown of the complex form of biomolecules present in the food into their simpler units is called digestion, which is achieved by some special chemical substances or biomolecules in our body. These chemical substances which help in the breakdown of complex biomolecules are known as biocatalysts or enzymes. Biocatalysts or enzymes. What are biocatalysts or enzymes? The special substances that help in the breakdown of complex biomolecules into their simpler units in our digestive system are known as biocatalysts or enzymes. Where are they going to be present and how are they produced? Right? Our digestive system is associated with certain digestive glands. Certain digestive glands that produce some digestive juices which contain these digestive enzymes. What are those digestive glands present in our digestive system? Salivary glands. Next. Pancreas. And liver. These are the three important digestive glands. Along with these three digestive glands, in our stomach, okay, in the stomach wall, in the lining of the stomach wall, special glands are present which are called gastric glands. Right? And in the small intestine wall also, it will produce, okay, certain digestive juice which is going to have major digestive enzymes. So, small intestinal glands. Then why are they not discussed as associated glands with the digestive system? Because salivary glands, pancreas, liver, they are clearly separate glands. Whereas gastric glands and small intestinal glands, they are present within the wall of the stomach and small intestine. They are not present in separate. So, whenever the question is asked, like what are the associated digestive glands in the digestive system, you need to first write these three followed by these two. Even if you forget these two also, you have to compulsorily write these three. These are very, very important. Okay. In our oral cavity, two types of digestion takes place. Okay, probably telling this way of explaining our nutrition is bit different because you will not be finding these words in your textbooks or in any of your guides. What are those two ways of digestion? Digestion means what? Breakdown of the food into breakdown of the complex biomolecules of food into simpler units. Two ways of digestion. Physical digestion and chemical digestion. According to me, the two ways of digestion means physical digestion and chemical digestion. What does it mean by chemical digestion and what does it mean by physical digestion? Let us learn the first, physical digestion. The food which we are taking in, for example, you are taking a guava. You are keeping the fruit inside the large size piece. Will you directly swallow it? What do? You will break it first into smaller pieces. Okay, you are taking the food bolus. What are you going to do it? Are you going to directly swallow it? No, you are first crushing it into smaller pieces. And you are making it to get wetted. Why these two things are important? Making the food into smaller sized, equal texture having particles helps in the chemical digestion. That is one thing. Why the food has to get wetted? The lining of the esophagus, the lining of the alimentary canal,
The lining of the alimentary canal is very, very soft. If the food is not in wetted condition, the hard food may cause some damage to the lining of the alimentary canal. So that it must be made wetted. Because of these two things, first the food is, in order to get properly digested, it is broken down into even sized smaller particles. That is by crushing the food with the help of teeth. Second one, the food is getting wetted in order to not to cause damage to the lining of alimentary canal. So, food is broken down into smaller pieces by crushing with the teeth. What about it's getting wetted? Food will get wetted with the saliva, which is released by salivary glands. Is saliva has got the purpose of only making the food to get wet? Is it having any other purpose? Salivary glands produce saliva, which will make the food get wetted. Along with that, the food contains carbohydrates in the form of starch, proteins, lipids and nucleic acids in it. The starch present in the food will be partially digested by the salivary amylase. The saliva contains salivary amylase. Some people pronounce it as salivary amylase. Whatever you want to pronounce, no problem. But remember the correct spelling. Salivary amylase or salivary amylase. Which is also called thiamine. P silent here. So, in the exam, if you are asked, describe the role of thiamine, don't get confused, at the same role of salivary amylase. What is its role? The starch will be partially digested into sugars. That too, if you properly chew it, if you immediately swallow it, its action cannot be carried out. Why? If you immediately swallow it, even though the food is getting mixed with the saliva, its action cannot be completed. Why? Saliva, see, I told biocatalysts are the engines that function in the breakdown of complex biomolecules into simpler units. Every particular biocatalyst is going to function at certain particular pH. Are you getting it? pH levels are very, very important for all the biocatalysts in the living organisms. So if a particular biocatalyst is able to work at acidic pH or at neutral pH or at alkaline pH, if that pH having environment is present, then only it will do its function, otherwise it will not. So when it is in the mouth, if the food is in the mouth the pH is maintained around 6.2 to 6.8, near neutral. Neutral means 7, near neutral. At that particular pH only salivary amylase will function. If food goes into the stomach, inside the stomach HCl is produced, which is highly acidic. Okay, at that acidic pH, salivary amylase cannot function. You get it?